January 28th, 1986. America and the world watch a space shuttle Challenger climbs toward the heavens. Seven astronauts, heroes, embarking on a journey to the frontier. On board, Krista McAuliffe, the first teacher bound for space. It was a symbol of progress, of human ingenuity touching the void. For 73 seconds, it was perfect. A billion-dollar machine, the pinnacle of engineering, defying gravity. 73 seconds. That's all it took for triumph to turn into a national tragedy. After months and months of investigation, the culprit is this. But just as interesting as the investigation and the ultimate cause of failure is how this disaster changed engineering forever. So on this episode, we're going to do a deep dive and figure this out. I'm Ricky, and this is 2 Bit Da Vinci. This video is brought to you by Delete Me. So the immediate question, inescapable, is how could the marvel of technology fail so catastrophically? The search for answers began instantly. A presidential commission led by William Rogers was assembled. They faced a daunting task, unraveling the mystery locked within twisted metal and conflicting accounts. But the clues they could find weren't buried in some complex, unknowable code. They were hidden in plain sight, in ignored warnings, in flawed decisions made under pressure, and deep inside the fiery heart of the rockets themselves. Specifically, in something deceptively simple, two rubber O-rings. The key lies in the shuttle's massive solid rocket boosters, the twin columns of controlled fury providing the primary thrust for liftoff. Built in segments, these giants were bolted together, and the integrity of the entire mission rested on the seals between those segments. Seals made in part by humble O-rings. To understand the failure, we first need to understand the machine and the tiny component that brought it down. So we actually 3D printed that very joint, not to scale, right here. You have the tang from one forward segment slotting into the clevis, this U-shaped groove on the right after bottom segment. Now, sealing this joint against the enormous pressure and heat of burning rocket fuel, we're talking over 5,000 degrees Fahrenheit, is absolutely critical. The primary seal was meant to be formed by this inner O-ring, made of a synthetic rubber called Viton. There's a second O-ring as backup, and in this channel, there was zinc chromate putty. The idea was simple. At ignition, the immense internal pressure would push this putty, compress the air in the joint, and instantly force the primary O-rings tight into the gap, creating a perfect seal before any hot gas could leak past. Simple, right? Well, here's where the first problem lies, a fundamental design issue. The joint would deflect toward the outside when pressurized, separating the O-rings in the clevis from the tang and increase the gap. Under the incredible ignition pressure, the metal casing itself actually bowed outward slightly. You can see it here. This phenomenon, called joint rotation or tang deformation, momentarily widened the very gap the O-rings needed to seal, and seal instantly. For this design to work, that primary O-ring absolutely had to be flexible enough, resilient enough, to spring into this widening gap faster than the billion-degree gas could sneak by. Its speed and flexibility were everything. This is central to what happened, and we'll get back to that in a minute. But before we do, here's the chilling part. This wasn't a secret discovered after the disaster. NASA and the booster manufacturer Morton Thiokol knew about the potential problems with this joint design almost from the beginning, as early as 1977. Internal memos discussed leakage studies on the exact joint and potential solutions. By 1978, concerns were raised that the design might not guarantee proper O-ring compression, potentially leading to blow-by. Blow-by is when hot gases escape through a gap in the O-ring. A lot of the topics we cover are counterintuitive or not immediately obvious. You know what's really not obvious? How exposed your personal information is online. It's why I've been a member of our sponsor, Delete Me, for 2 years now. Delete Me is a hands-free subscription service that'll remove all your personal information that's being sold online. And it's not just a one-time scan. Just look at all these listings that have been reviewed each quarter and how the amount of exposed data is going down over time. I just got my 8th quarterly report, and Delete Me has scanned over 2,300 listings, and it's just amazing to see how the amount of data being exposed just keeps going down over time. And remember, Delete Me isn't just for you. There's family plans so you can protect your entire family and keep all of their data safe, because we all have a lot on our minds, and your privacy probably doesn't come up very often. It's why I let Delete Me stay vigilant and do all the work so I don't have to think about it. Have you ever heard the expression, if something is free, you're the product being sold? So join Delete Me and save 20% on all plans with my code Ricky. Links in the description. Huge thanks to Delete Me and you. Now back to the show. I just went through probably a dozen reports of O-ring issues and concerns, memorandums. Now, this isn't that uncommon. I remember back in my Navy days, we'd have lingering issues with components that we knew were kind of faulty. In an ideal world, we'd want to fix. But some of these things take years to fix. Like if you wanted to redesign a part, it might be 5 or 6 years to get it flight worthy, certified, and ready to be put on a craft. And so a lot of engineering sometimes is mitigation, but this one, somehow this one feels a little different. It's such a critical component and it's so at the mercy of fitting and stresses and temperatures that it seems something that they should have maybe taken more seriously. NASA engineers were clear in stating that Morton Thiokol had to redesign the joint. There really was no reason not to, but they didn't. A year later, the joint movement was explicitly called unacceptable, predicting damage to the O-rings. In 1979, after meeting with the O-ring manufacturer and third-party experts, NASA engineers documented a disturbing consensus. Given the design flaws allowing potential gaps, the experts were actually shocked that the O-rings didn't fail more often. I kid you not, it's in black and white. Given the joint's design, they expected to have problems with nearly every flight. So joint design itself put immense pressure on these O-rings to perform perfectly every single time under dynamic, stressful conditions. And at 17 of 24 flights in the following year, the little O-ring that could did perform perfectly, despite the design flaws. But on January 28, 1986, another factor entered the equation. A factor that engineers had been warning about, but management struggled to grasp. The bitter, unprecedented cold. Central Florida experienced a severe cold snap. Temperatures plummeted overnight, far below anything previously experienced on a shuttle launch day. Think about rubber in the cold. It gets stiff, less pliable, less bouncy. Physicist Richard Feynman, part of the Rogers Commission, famously demonstrated this with a simple experiment, dunking a piece of O-ring material into ice water. It lost its resiliency. It couldn't spring back quickly. Now, to show you just how impactful temperature is on O-rings, this here is at room temperature. If you can see that, you can kind of see very elastic, returns back to form, right? I pull on it and it comes back. Elastic deformation comes back to its original form. Here I have a bowl of ice water. So the water and ice means that the temperature should be around 32 degrees Fahrenheit, 0 degrees Celsius. It's cold. If I pull this out and try the same thing, you can kind of see it's much stiffer. And it takes a lot longer to return to normal. It doesn't have the same characteristics. Now, if you were to cold this even more, that impact becomes even more pronounced. Let's see. One is very hard, very stiff, and doesn't big time difference. This one is much, much stiffer, and it's slower to return. And tests confirmed exactly this. Look at this graph. It shows how quickly the O-ring material recovers its shape after being compressed at different temperatures. Down here, at the temperatures Challenger faced around 30 degrees Fahrenheit or even lower, the O-rings barely recovered to the quarter of its size in the crucial first second. So picture it, ignition. The joint flexes open, but the primary O-ring on the right booster, brittle from the cold, is too slow, too stiff to seal the gap instantly. That allowed searing hot gas over 5,000 degrees to blow right past it. That's the blow-by. But this wasn't just a theory, it was physics. And the evidence was there from the very first fraction of a second. At 0.678 seconds after ignition, cameras captured a distinct puff of dark gray smoke spurting from the aft field joint of the right-hand booster. The booster on the south side of the stack facing the brunt of the cold westerly winds. It was the telltale sign. The primary O-ring hadn't sealed. A leaky joint, a known design flaw, exacerbated by freezing temperatures. Surely this was cause for alarm. It was. But the warnings tragically got lost in a chain of flawed communication and management pressure. You see, this wasn't the first time these O-rings had shown signs of trouble. Data from previous missions revealed a disturbing pattern. Look at this table. O-ring distress, erosion, or heat damage had occurred on at least 7 prior missions involving 9 different joints. NASA and thiokol management in pre-launch discussions pointed to incidents happening at warmer temperatures, arguing the cold wasn't the decisive factor. They saw 8 incidents above 50 degrees Fahrenheit and essentially dismissed the temperature correlation. But this analysis was dangerously flawed. As engineers desperately tried to point out, they ignored the successful flights. When you include the previous 17 missions with zero O-ring problems, a stark picture emerges. Above 65 degrees Fahrenheit, only 3 flights out of 20 had issues, about an 18% incident rate. Below 65 degrees, every single flight, 4 out of 4, showed O-ring distress. There were no successful, uneventful flights launched below 65 degrees. And Mission 51C, launched at 53 degrees, the previous record low, saw 3 separate O-ring erosion incidents, including the worst damage seen of any flight before Challenger. Based on this data, thiokol engineers initially told NASA they could not recommend launching below 53 degrees Fahrenheit, the coldest point at which they knew they hadn't had a catastrophic failure. But on launch day for Challenger, the temperature wasn't just below 53, it wasn't even close. Models predicted that the critical aft joint of the right booster would be around 28 to 30 degrees Fahrenheit at launch time, right in the danger zone identified by the resiliency tests. But the models might have been optimistic. Between 7 and 9 a.m. that morning, just hours before launch, the pad was an ice rink. An inspection crew found thick ice everywhere. On the launch tower, the platform, even coating parts of the shuttle stack. They used an infrared pyrometer to check surface temperatures. The left booster showed about 25 degrees Fahrenheit, close to the prediction. But the right booster, the side facing the cold wind, the instrument read approximately 8 degrees or minus 13 degrees Celsius. Far colder than any model, far colder than any previous successful launch, deep into the territory where O-rings become dangerously brittle. 8 degrees. A shocking number given the known concerns. Surely this would stop the countdown. No. The reading, unbelievably, was never formally passed on to the key decision makers as a constraint violation. Why? The official reason given was that the surface temperature wasn't a specific launch commit criterion on the rulebook. They measured it, but the procedure didn't require them to act on it if it wasn't part of the formal checklist. Which then makes me wonder, why measure it at all? The ice crews finished their work. The countdown continued. At 11:38 a.m., Challenger launched. The decision to launch wasn't made in ignorance that morning. It was sealed the night before in a now infamous teleconference between NASA managers and Morton Thiokol. Thiokol engineers led by Roger Boisjoli and Arnie Thompson presented their data, showing the link between cold temperatures and O-ring damage, reiterating their recommendations. Do not launch below 53 degrees. But NASA managers at Marshall Space Flight Center, under intense pressure to maintain an ambitious launch schedule, pushed back hard. They challenged the data's interpretation. They questioned the engineers' conclusions. The pressure mounted. One NASA official reportedly demanded Thiokol prove it was unsafe, instead of Thiokol proving it was safe, a dangerous reversal of engineering logic. Feeling the heat, Thiokol senior management asked for a 5-minute break to meet offline, just amongst themselves. This meeting stretched to 30 minutes. Inside that closed-door meeting, a battle raged between engineering caution and management priorities. According to testimony, Thiokol Senior Vice President Jerry Mason told his Vice President of Engineering, Bob Lund, to take off his engineering hat and put on his management hat, essentially to prioritize the business relationship with NASA and the launch schedule over the stark technical warnings from his own engineers. The engineers pleaded, but management's decision was made. Thiokol rejoined the conference call. They formally reversed their position. They told NASA their data was inconclusive, and that they now recommended launching Challenger. NASA management, hearing what they wanted to hear, accepted the recommendation. The fate of Challenger and its crew was sealed by the management decision that overruled clear, data-driven engineering concern. 73 seconds after liftoff, the inevitable happened. The cold, stiff O-ring failed to seal. Hot gas burned through the joint. Flame impinged on the strut holding the booster to the external tank. The strut failed, the booster pivoted, striking the tank full of volatile liquid hydrogen and oxygen. And the result? Catastrophe. The Rogers Commission laid bare the devastating truth. The disaster was caused by the O-ring failure, exacerbated by cold temperatures. But critically, it was rooted in a flawed decision-making process, poor communication, and a management structure that allowed scheduled pressure and programmatic goals to silence legitimate engineering dissent. The Challenger disaster forced changes. The solid rocket booster joints were redesigned. NASA implemented stricter safety protocols and communication channels. The O-rings became a symbol, a harsh lesson taught in engineering schools worldwide about the importance of material science, thorough testing, and listening to expert warning. But have the core lessons about decision-making under pressure truly been learned? Recent tragedies like the OceanGate Titan submersible implosion, where warnings from experts about safety concerns were allegedly overridden by a drive for innovation and meeting schedules, echo Challenger's painful narrative. Today, we're in a new space race where there's new companies, private companies, driven by profit and quarterly earnings to push the frontier of human knowledge. Like OceanGate in the oceans, like SpaceX, Blue Origin, we have so many new examples now, not government-run entities, but private ones. And private ones have much more pressure to perform. If you're the space company that raised billions of dollars and you keep letting your schedule shift and you keep scrapping flights, it would be difficult to continue to raise funding. So this Challenger disaster and its impact on engineering is more important today than ever. We now live in an age where private companies are doing what governments used to do. And that's amazing, and I'm all for it. But this problem is going to be continually challenged, where management and leadership is going to want to push the boundary and want to avoid the engineers because engineers are overly cautious by design. We understand just how dangerous every one of these decisions can be. But if you're trying to raise funding and there's three other companies doing what you're doing, are you going to really listen to the engineers and continue to scrap missions and postpone and delay in the face of mounting pressure? That will be the question. So we now learn this, the stories of Morton Thiokol, that infamous teleconference, and NASA's decisions and everything else in engineering school, in mishap investigation classes, and so much more, because it shows you the importance of having a really clear go, no go priority. If you've ever heard the term go, no go, famously used in NASA for how all systems, all teams have to report back that something is safe to do before actually doing it. And this disaster reminds us just how important it is to listen. But as far as what comes next, hopefully all the private companies doing the great things will listen. And this will be one of those moments in time that we as a human species learn from. But ultimately, time will tell. What do you think? What was the ultimate legacy of Challenger? And what lessons have we learned? Have we improved? Or are we doomed to repeat history? Sound off in the comments below. So that's the story of how the Challenger disaster changed engineering forever. If you thought that was cool, check out that video next. And until next week, I'm Ricky Tudor Da Vinci. Thank you so much for watching.